Pokemon is a weird series, and I wouldn't have it any other way. The creativity put into these games has led to the creation of some of my favorite creatures in all of fiction. But at the start of this gigantic multimedia titan, there were a few games on the original Game Boy, being the first generation of Pokemon. As someone who was born a bit after the second generation was released, and didn't start playing until around the third generation, Red and Blue almost feel like anomalies. There are a bunch of things that make it feel slightly off compared to the rest of the series, some major and some minor. Now, this isn't a video aiming to criticize or tear down Gen 1. God knows there's enough of that on the internet. Weird doesn't necessarily mean bad. So in this video, I'm just going to talk about a few things that interest me. Alright, I'm going to start this section off with a lightning round of a bunch of normal type moves. Don't worry, I'll explain why in a minute. Headbutt, 70 power, 30% chance to flinch. Dizzy Punch, 70 power, no chance of confusing in Gen 1. Slash, 70 power with a high chance to be a critical hit. Mega Punch, 80 power, 85 accuracy. Razor Wind, 80 power, 75 accuracy, and takes a turn to charge up. Slam, 80 power, 75 accuracy. Hyper Fang, 80 power, 10% chance to flinch. Tri-Attack, 80 power, no added effect in this generation. Body Slam, 85 power, 35% chance to paralyze. Now, why did I list a bunch of moves in the ballpark of 70 to 85 power? Well, anything below 60-ish power is kind of weak, or oftentimes useless if it's 40 power or under. And on the other end, moves that are 90 and up are considered pretty strong. This much is obvious. However, what if I told you that the attacks I listed off are almost like a weird sort of replacement for your normal attack you'd have in any other JRPG? Full disclosure, some of the stuff I'm going to talk about is based off of a post by CinderSky in the True Pokemon subreddit. Specifically this sentence right here. Quote, all TMs were supposed to be attainable only once, which meant the expectation was that most monsters would use normal type moves as their bread and butter if their type moves weren't effective in the situation. This sort of shifted my perspective about Generation 1. You see, a lot of Pokemon's level up moves looked like this, where they had a lot of normal type moves with little to no same type attacks. This meant, like the post says, you'd basically be stuck with normal type moves if you either weren't equipped with the right TM moves, or you just didn't have the right Pokemon for the job. This then lets you see why the rock type was surprisingly decent in this game. Sure, it's weak to grass, water, and a few other types, but it resisted the most common type in the game. If you've ever watched a J-Rose video, this is obvious. Brock acts as a literal stonewall for a lot of Pokemon, because a lot of them just don't get moves that are good against rock. Now this mostly applies to the single player side of things. For player versus player battles, you kinda need to have more than just your level up moves if you want to get anywhere. There's a reason why Bolt Beam, a combination of Thunderbolt and either Ice Beam or Blizzard on the same Pokemon, is as infamous as it is. But you've gotta remember, Gen 1 was designed as an RPG first. Battling other human beings was kind of an afterthought, and you can see this in more areas than just move pools. Yeah, the Psychic type is overpowered and unbalanced in this generation, but it makes slightly more sense when you take into account that the majority of the evil trainers in this game use Poison types, which Psychic is super effective against. Couple that with Pokemon like Abra and Jinx being pretty elusive, and Mewtwo being an endgame reward, and you kinda see why this is the case. Of course, not every single design decision in Gen 1 is good, and there are plenty of arguments as to why it's the most poorly designed generation. But it's different, and I kinda like it. Having an overpowered Pokemon feels kinda cool, even if it's unbalanced as all hell. But anyway, this first section is getting a bit too long, so I'm gonna talk about some other weird things in this weird-ass generation. Now, this sort of thing reminds me that this specific early era of Pokemon feels more like a traditional classic RPG than the other generations. I may not be super well versed in the history of other RPGs, but I do know that one of the coolest things to look forward to in some of the old Dragon Quest games was just seeing new monsters when you progress to a new area. I guess this is all to say that Pokemon are monsters, pocket monsters, but dangerous all the same, which is probably why a bunch of trainers carry whips. Of course, you've got Team Rocket grunts, but there are also Tamers, Q-Balls, Sabrina, and the two types of cool trainers. It's cool to abuse Pokemon. Even the main character was meant to carry a whip at one point, and this is what I mean by this generation feeling like an anomaly. When you think of Pokemon, you'd normally think of the whole overarching theme of friendship and stuff like that. You'd never see a character in a modern-day Pokemon game just threaten their pocket monster with a whip. This is also a thing you wouldn't really think too much about, but have you ever really listened to the wild Pokemon battle theme in this generation? If you're anything like me, you've probably heard this song thousands of times before, but this is the only wild battle theme that doesn't really have a happy-sounding portion to it. I know nothing about music theory, but go listen to any of the other wild Pokemon themes. They all usually have this friendly sort of vibe to them, but not in Gen 1. Even the remakes attempt to make this song seem less threatening, but why should they? Pokemon are threatening. They're giant monsters who can cause earthquakes and stuff. It's no wonder why the trainers carry whips. Like with most things in this video, the trainers with whips were removed in the remakes, except for the tamers. Again, this makes sense. Whips give off a needlessly cruel feeling, but one thing that never got buffed out in any of the remakes was... You could fill an entire video with just Lavender Town related oddities, but when you take it at face value, this is a Pokemon cemetery. Now, there have been many grave sites across the series, but none of them require you to obtain a special lens just to identify ghost Pokemon. In all fairness, when comparing the Pokemon Tower to other similar places in the Pokemon universe, it isn't too different. Mournful trainers gather to pay their respects to their departed friends, and ghost Pokemon are almost always found throughout. I guess the whole area in Gen 1 felt a bit more eerie for a couple of reasons. In every generation except Gen 1, there are Pokemon breeding mechanics. Now, what does this have to do with ghost Pokemon? Well, it actually messes with a few pieces of lore that were implemented in Gen 1, but subsequently forgotten about. The most obvious case here is Cubone. The idea of this poor, lost, orphan Pokemon who wears the skull of its dead mother is still kind of tragic. It becomes even more heartbreaking when it's explicitly stated that Team Rocket killed Marowak, and you have to calm its soul to progress. For the longest time, this was one of the few wild Pokemon that absolutely couldn't be caught. Now, all of this becomes a bit diminished when, in Gen 2 onwards, you could just breed Marowak and produce a perfectly healthy Cubone. The mother is clearly fine, so where did it get the skull? Of course, from a gameplay standpoint, they weren't just gonna make you sacrifice your Marowak every time you wanted a Cubone egg, but it nonetheless messes with this specific piece of continuity. Same goes for being able to breed ghost-type Pokemon. If it's a ghost, how exactly does it become a newborn from an egg? It doesn't matter, and I'm not saying anything insane like ghost Pokemon shouldn't be able to breed. It's just one tiny reason I think that this part of Kanto is done best in Gen 1, and Gen 1 alone. You know, other Pokemon villains are pretty evil, but I don't think any of them have flat-out killed a Pokemon like Team Rocket grunts. It's not like this was part of Team Rocket's master plan or anything. This was just part of a get-rich-quick scheme to sell some skulls for profit. The Marowak in question even tried escaping, but in an act of needless cruelty, they killed it anyway. What kind of asshole would actually willingly associate with these guys? Right off the bat, I'm going to let you know that this is a fan theory. I get it, you've seen YouTubers talk about fan theories before, and you get annoyed when they purposely leave out information to make it seem more legit. I'm gonna try not to do that, but even if I make some oversight that totally disproves the theory, I still think it's kind of interesting. Okay, let's start by going over all the times you meet with your rival. Obviously, there's the beginning of the game, as well as the optional battle on Route 22. You then meet him in Cerulean City, the SS Anne, Pokemon Tower in Lavender Town, Sylph Company, again on Route 22, and then finally at the Pokemon League. Now let's assume that Blue went through the Kanto region the same way as you, which is a pretty reasonable assumption. He's always one step ahead of you at every turn. The first time you, the player, encounter Team Rocket is in Mount Moon, so we can assume the same is true for Blue. This means that, obviously, the first time you battle him in Oak's Lab, as well as the optional fight on Route 22, are both before he would have joined Team Rocket, as he'd never have met them. After you trek through Mount Moon and head to Cerulean City, Blue stops you before you can head north up to Nugget Bridge. Notice how he specifically comes down from the bridge, as opposed to the much easier path with the ledge off to the right. Of course, at the very top of the bridge, after the five trainers, is a man who offers you admission into Team Rocket. You aren't given the option to say yes, but who's to say Blue wouldn't? The encounter on the SS Anne is actually pretty uninteresting, aside from his sprite being different than the first few encounters. In Pokemon Tower, we get a few more small pieces of evidence, although they're not particularly strong. Of course, we have the infamous line, "Your Pokemon don't look dead, I can at least make them faint," that he says before the battle. After he loses, he says, "How's your Pokedex coming, pal? I just caught a Cubone. I can't find the grown-up Marowak yet. I doubt there are any left. Well, I'd better get going. I've got a lot to accomplish, pal. Smell you later." To me, this line implies that he at least knows that Marowak are endangered and are being hunted by Team Rocket, but he clearly wants nothing to do with it. Here's the thing though, if Blue tried going to the top floor of the tower, he'd have been stopped by the ghost Marowak, but he clearly says he hasn't seen any Marowak whatsoever. If he's in the tower in search of Pokemon, he clearly has a Sylphscope, so it's not like he couldn't see it. Of course, just beyond the ghost Marowak is where Team Rocket is holding Mr. Fuji. But now the most damning piece of evidence. Even if you're not on board with this theory, you have to admit it's kind of weird that Blue stops you right before you're able to reach the teleporter that takes you to Giovanni during the Sylph Company takeover. Before you battle him, Blue will say, "What kept you, Red? Ha ha ha. I thought you'd turn up if I waited here. I guess Team Rocket slowed you down. Not that I care. I saw you in Saffron, so I decided to see if you got better." I mean, he clearly states he doesn't give a shit about Team Rocket, which you'd think he would, since their whole MO is stealing, abusing, and exploiting Pokemon. They're literally in the middle of taking over an international company's office building by force, yet he's unfazed. If he wasn't part of Team Rocket, he would have had to fight tooth and nail just to get into the room Giovanni's in. But do you want to know the best part? In this game, Blue actually has unique text programmed in that he would have said if you lose to him. This doesn't actually show up in the game, aside from the first few encounters where he'll say, "Yeah, am I great or what?" In every other battle, he won't say anything. Most of these unused pieces of dialogue are pretty standard, so I'll go through them quickly. In the optional battle on Route 22, he'll say, "What? Why do I have two Pokemon? You should catch some more too." In Cerulean City, he says, "Heh, you're no match for my genius." On the SS Anne, "Red, what are you, seasick? You should shape up, pal." In Pokemon Tower, "Well, look at your wimpy Pokemon. Toughen them up a bit more." And in Sylph Company, in the room right before Giovanni, he says, "How can I put this? You're not good enough to play with us big boys. Now I need you to suspend your disbelief for a bit and disregard that this may have been a mistranslation, or just the fact that this text is unused and therefore isn't canon." The fact that he specifically says "us big boys" in reference to him and Giovanni is the thing that made me truly believe in this theory. Another minor piece of info is that, when you enter the Viridian Gym, which was supposedly closed until you defeated Giovanni at Sylph, it shows that Blue won before you did, like with every other gym, as evidenced by the statues right at the front. Giovanni is obviously crushed after you beat him, so I would guess that he just gave the Earth Badge to Blue instead of Blue actually defeating him. The next two encounters with Blue don't have super interesting text if you lose, but I might as well cover them for the sake of completion. On Route 22, after getting the 8th badge, he'll say, "Hahaha, Red, that's your best. You're nowhere near as good as me, pal. Go train some more, you loser." And if you lose the championship battle, he says, "Hahaha, I won, I won. I'm too good for you, Red. You did well to even reach me. Blue, the Pokemon genius. Nice try, loser." To cap off this theory, I'll talk about Professor Oak's text right at the end of the game, and how it kind of relates to the overall themes at play here. Upon winning against Blue, Oak will say, "Blue, do you understand why you lost? You've forgotten to treat your Pokemon with trust and love." Throughout the whole game, Team Rocket has clearly been depicted as not treating their Pokemon with any care whatsoever, mainly using them as tools, or at the very worst, abusing and killing them. Not saying Blue would go that far, but there's clearly a divide between how him and the player are shown to treat their Pokemon. Oak solidifies this in his next line. "Red, you understand that your victory was not just your own doing. The bond you share with your Pokemon is marvelous." finally, I think it's interesting that Giovanni has this to say about you when you first defeat him. I see that you raise your Pokemon with utmost care. A child like you would never understand what I hope to achieve. Just another interesting bit of text that clearly shows where you stand on the divide of caring about your Pokemon or not. Now I will admit that this plot thread, if you can even call it that, was obviously abandoned, or at the very least not expanded upon as the series progressed. In every other game, Blue is not shown to have an association with Team Rocket, and the same is true for other related media. Well, that last section was pretty long, so I'll end this video with a shorter topic. What actually is a Pokemon Master? Well, the only correct answer is that it's a marketing gimmick, intentionally left vague so that Ash's journey of becoming a Pokemon Master can effectively go on forever. But that's related to the anime. We can still speculate about the games. Even though the term Pokemon Master is heavily associated with Pokemon as a whole, it doesn't actually appear in the games all that much. In Generation 1, as well as Fire Red and Leaf Green, when you beat Lance, he'll say, "That's it. I hate to admit it, but you are a Pokemon Master." Seems pretty clear-cut right there. If Blue wasn't ahead of you, you'd be crowned champion yourself, therefore also becoming a Pokemon Master. But that begs the question, why have two separate titles? Why not just call the champion a Pokemon Master? It should be noted that in some languages, the word Master is used in place of champion. Specifically, Danish, Finnish, French, Polish, and Swedish all have this distinction. I can't speak for any of the other languages, but I know for French, the reason they did this is because gym leaders are called champions, so the decision was made to call the actual champion the Master. There is another school of thought that claims the only way to become a Pokemon Master is to catch every Pokemon, with some people saying you need to catch every Pokemon and become the champion. I like this line of thinking better. I mean, it makes sense. The goal of becoming a Pokemon Master is left vague enough so that Ash can continue his journey forever. And if you too want to become a Pokemon Master, your journey will also last forever, because they keep adding new Pokemon every couple of years. That's about all for now. But if there's anything to be said about Pokemon, it's that there's always something to talk about. There are definitely more weird things about the first generation and the series as a whole that I'd love to talk about in the future. Happy 25th anniversary, Pokemon. This series has definitely had its ups and downs, but I don't think I'll ever stop truly being a fan of it. If you want to hear more of my insane ramblings about Pokemon and other video games, be sure to subscribe and stuff. I'll see you in the next one. Goodbye. Cleveland Steamer.